A lot of times when I presented in the past for this group, you've seen me kind of focus on certain topics. Like as Cheryl noted, sometimes we'll talk about just IRS reporting, 1094, 1095s. We'll kind of do a deep dive into certain topics. Right now, the good news, as you'll see, is that you've kind of survived a lot of the major Affordable Care Act changes, and there's not any one topic that's kind of looming out there that we just need to drill into for 2 hours. So this is more of a grab bag in terms of our presentation here today. Kind of a how did we get here, let's gaze into the crystal ball, what's coming up next. In terms of mental health parity, we'll emphasize that, as you'll see here, just because there's been a lot of compliance enforcement going on there. HIPAA audits, we'll talk about HIPAA, Fair Labor Standard Act changes, ERISA Section 510, focus on some new ACA rules which are out there, some non-discrimination rules, health reimbursement arrangements may need some changes here by the end of the year, we'll talk about those, essential health benefits, MEC and AIL reporting, that 1094, 1095, there's been some follow-up there. And some new guidance just issued last week, too. And then the bulk of our time at the end, in the second half, we'll focus on wellness programs. There are some very significant wellness plan changes out there, lots of impact in terms of the employer-sponsored group health plans, so we'll focus on that. One quick slide on ERISA preemption, some good news there. No real major action items for you, which is good. So in terms of how we got here and what's next, couple quick points. First of all, when we first started helping out employers with the Affordable Care Act, I put together a chart, a list of everything that could impact employer-sponsored plans. There were about 36 changes, about 35, 36 changes that employers or TPAs or insurance companies had to work on as a result of this. And the good news is that you have complied with about 32 to 33 of those. You survived the vast, vast majority of them. Going back to covering kids until age 26, you know, grandfather plan issues, all those things are kind of in the rear view mirror, which is good news for you all. So congratulations, a little pat on your back there. You've done a good job with getting through all this. There are a couple lingering things which are still coming up. The Cadillac tax is a big one. I know that the Alliance has been focused on that, as have a bunch of other groups. In terms of either getting it delayed or getting it repealed, repeal would be the best. Cadillac tax, of course, is that 40% excise tax on high-cost health plans. Used to be effective January 1, 2018. Two-year delay, January 1, 2020 is the new effective date here, so that's very good news. It still, I think, is a concern for employers, especially because we don't know for sure what's going to happen with it. Will it actually kick in 2020? Will it be delayed further? There's obviously bipartisan support usually for this kind of delay. Democrats feel pressure from, for example, unions, which don't want to pay this tax, that they're worried about their rich benefits. Republicans just don't like taxes, so you would think that Democrats and Republicans could get together and perhaps do a further delay, perhaps do a repeal. I don't know, we'll see. We also are thinking about whether the political analysis will change after President Obama leaves. Right now, President Obama is very protective of the Affordable Care Act. He wants it to be funded fully, and this helps pay for some portion of the ACA. So we'll see if the political dynamic changes. And of course, as the IRS issues more guidance, I'm sure the Alliance will keep you all informed of those changes. And we may, you know, 2 years from now, have to do a whole separate session just on this Cadillac tax. But for now, just know that it's still out there, and we'll cross our fingers that it will disappear at some point. Non-discrimination rules for fully insured, non-grandfather plans, those are still out there, lingering. They were supposed to have kicked in 2011. But they got pushed back in December of 2010. The IRS said basically you don't have to worry about non-discrimination rules if you're fully insured. So if you have a fully insured plan, you can be very discriminatory. You can let execs in on day one, rank and file have to wait until day 90. You can pay for the cost of the coverage for the executives, not for the rank and file. You can do a lot more in terms of fully insured plans right now as compared to self-funded plans, which have the 105H non-discrimination rules that apply to them. We'll see, we have no hints whatsoever in terms of whether the IRS will ever actually release any guidance whatsoever in this context. There are some other changes too which are looming. Many of you have heard about some new reporting rules. There's some new Form 5500 proposed changes which just came out. Those would take effect in 2019, so kind of a ways down the road. As part of that, there are some new reports which you most likely will have to include. Some of them are ACA driven. We're not going to cover them here today because, again, 2019 is just a little too far away. There's also something called the HPID requirement, the Health Plan Identifier requirement. This was supposed to have kicked in last year. Many of you should have already had these numbers associated with your health plans. Again, that got delayed. We have no indication when that will really kick in. You can continue to ignore it. Same thing with the HIPAA certification rules. If you have a health plan that's self-funded, you're supposed to, in theory, certify to the federal government by the end of last year that you actually comply with the HIPAA standard transaction rules. No way to actually certify. That appears to have been delayed, basically. So I think you can continue to safely ignore that one, too. In terms of the elections, the upcoming elections, you may have noticed that we have, obviously, a major presidential election coming up here. We've gotten some questions about what will happen as a result of the election. You know, what are the positions of the candidates here? And a couple points to note. For example, Hillary Clinton. In general, Democrats, of course, don't want to repeal the ACA. They don't want to replace the ACA. Hillary Clinton has talked about strengthening the ACA, making it a little bit better, improving coverage. I don't foresee significant impact in terms of anything that she said about employer plans. She's talked about maybe offering Medicare not for all, as Bernie Sanders wanted, but Medicare for more, where maybe once you hit age 50, you'll be allowed to participate and buy into Medicare. If there is that Medicare for more expansion, I mean, there could be an impact from an employer perspective. You might be able to perhaps encourage some of your older employees, maybe who are more likely to incur claims, you might be able to encourage them to go to Medicare if it really is expanded like that. And so we'll see how that works. Again, we don't know. That's very speculative yet. Donald Trump, in terms of his positions, I say ask again later here on the slide. A little bit unknown. He said kind of contradictory things. He said that he doesn't want people in the streets dying, that he wants to have health insurance coverage, he wants to cover people. But he's also talked about repealing and replacing the Affordable Care Act. So no real specific provisions there. He's talked about selling insurance across state lines, improving HSAs. So there is sort of an undercurrent of the traditional Republican ideas that he's promoted a little bit. But again, it's hard to say exactly what's going to happen there. Other possible changes here, tax reform next year. Paul Ryan, Wisconsin's own Paul Ryan, clearly a proponent, kind of a tax nerd at heart, which you got to appreciate, really wants to do some kind of changes here. So it's possible that there would be some major rewrite of the tax code. Last time we had a major rewrite of tax code, 30 years ago, 1986 was the last time. Interestingly, there were benefit changes back then, too. That's what introduced COBRA, right? That's when COBRA kind of came into effect, was when they started tweaking some of these tax code changes back then. And so we'll see. Once they start getting under the hood and making changes here, it's possible that we'll see significant changes with respect to all these tax provisions. Probably the most threatening one from my perspective is the tax exclusion for the value of employer-sponsored health plan coverage. Right now, if you offer a very rich plan to your employees, and let's suppose it's family coverage and it costs $25,000 a year, cell phone coverage, $15,000 a year, whatever the numbers are, your employees, of course, don't pay taxes on it. And you as employers don't withhold FICA and FUTA from it. It's a very nice tax exclusion. There's bipartisan support right now from both Republicans and Democrats to cap that tax exclusion. So if the value of family coverage is $25,000 per year, maybe it'd be capped at $20,000. So there'd be a $5,000 difference, a $5,000 taxable difference, where your employees have to pay real income taxes on that $5,000. And you as an employer would have to withhold on that $5,000. Interestingly enough, again, somewhat surprising, there is Democratic support. I think they view it as a new revenue source. There's Republican support for the concept, too, even though it is sort of a new tax. Republican support, I think, under the theory that they want to have people have skin in the game, they want to have an incentive for people to be wise users of health insurance. So there is some support. Very bad, I think, in general for the employer-sponsored system. So we'll see if that kind of sneaks in there. Exchanges really doesn't impact employers too much unless you're participating in the shop exchange, which has not been all that popular. There are some problems with the individual markets right now. We saw Aetna announced yesterday that they're pulling out of 11 of their 15 markets. UHC has been pulling out. The co-ops have been failing in general. Over half of the co-ops which were established are now gone. So kind of very frothy here. I mean, if we think that we in the group market and the employer market have it difficult, really much more turbulent in the individual market. But again, doesn't really impact us too much here. All right, mental health parity. First of all, any questions on that so far? Okay, great. Mental health parity. So mental health parity rules, why am I raising them? Well, even though they date back to November of 2013, so almost 3 years ago, we have not seen a lot of clients or TPAs or PBMs or other folks really roll up their sleeves and get involved in them. And as we'll talk about in the last couple slides in this topic, there's been sort of a new push on to enforce mental health parity rules. So I felt it was worth, you know, 4 or 5 slides to kind of refresh your memory about these rules. Mental health parity, substance use disorder rules, to me are probably the worst rules out there. So they're worse than anything under the Affordable Care Act. They're worse than ERISA, they're worse than COBRA. They're really the most difficult ones to comply with. And the reason for that is, I think, a couple different factors. One is that the rules are not extremely well written. And also, they have two component parts to them, and they're very different components. One part, which we're not going to cover in detail here, is focusing on non-quantitative treatment limitations. So, for example, many of you probably have plans that say that you exclude residential treatment facilities, or you cap residential treatment facilities at a certain number of days where people can stay there. If you have those kinds of exclusions that are kind of non-quantitative, where you're trying to pick on maybe providers of these kinds of mental health services or things or other kind of arrangements where maybe you don't pay for 100% of the cost of the provider charges for mental health, you pay for 75%, while on the medical side you pay for 90% of their normal costs, those are non-quantitative problems where you're kind of picking on these mental health providers or you're trying to discourage people from using mental health services. All of those could violate these rules, and it still remains a very common plan design here today to have those kinds of provisions. And for you to figure out if you have an issue in there, you'd also have to kind of dig into what the providers are paid. That information is not usually provided to you as an employer. Something that your PBM would have for the drugs, and something your TPA would have for the major medical claims, surgical claims, but it's not information that is really presented to you, making your analysis more difficult. So non-quantitative is very difficult, I think, to deal with. In addition to that, there's also a more mathematical quantitative test that we wanted to walk you through here, too. Quantitative test at least has numbers, so I can show you how it works. It's a little bit easier to explain. But it's also very difficult. By show of hands, maybe in Madison here, how many of you work with a TPA who has given you a report saying, yes, you passed the mental health parity rules? Has anybody seen anything like that from a TPA or a consultant? Okay, yeah, for everyone outside, the answer is zero, which is basically what I expected, because again, this has been sort of ignored a little bit here. The reason why I think some of these vendors are not helping out very much is it's very difficult for them. As you'll see here, the analysis on the quantitative side could vary from client to client. So TPAs are very good at producing kind of set health plan documents that are not, they don't change very much from one client to another. There will be some tweaks. But the way that these rules work is it's sort of random in terms of whether a client passes it or not. In theory, a TPA would have to run a test for each and every client, even if the terms of the plan are 100% identical. They could have some clients pass, some clients fail. So it's based upon utilization and usage, as you'll see here in a second. So in terms of the quantitative provisions, here's what the plan said, or here's what the rules say. If the plan provides both medical, surgical, and mental health substance use disorder benefits, the plan can't apply any financial requirement or treatment limitation to mental health or substance use disorder benefits in any classification that's more restrictive than the predominant financial requirement or treatment limitation applying to medical, surgical. You know, words that only a lawyer could love, right? So what it basically says is, hey everybody, you need to kind of run the numbers. And if you are imposing higher co-payments, higher co-insurance, or if it has the impact of kind of picking on mental health or substance use disorder benefits, then we have a problem here. That's basically what they're trying to say. All those terms are defined. If we were doing kind of a full, you know, 60 minutes on this, I'd kind of walk you through, but we'll just walk you through one quick example involving predominant. What this term predominant means basically is, you check to see if that limitation, that co-payment, that co-insurance, the deductible, whatever it is, whatever kind of financial hit a person has to incur in order to get mental health benefits, you check to make sure that it applies to at least two-thirds of the medical surgical benefits in that classification. There's between 6 and 13 classifications, so you have to do this between 6 and 13 times. Outpatient in-network, outpatient outer-network, inpatient in-network, inpatient outer-network, emergency room. So you, in theory, have to run this multiple times. But for right now, let's just focus on one, like inpatient outer-network. So if you don't pass this first test, this two-thirds test, then you can't have any of these financial requirements apply to mental health or substance use disorder benefits in that classification. And let's throw out a more concrete example here. Suppose a plan has five levels of co-payments. What is the maximum co-payment that can apply to mental health and substance use disorder benefits? So again, five levels of co-payments. If you have, by the way, just one level of co-payment, this test is almost always passed. It's a lot easier to do all this. If you have two levels, it becomes more difficult. Three, it becomes worse, etc. So the more complicated your plan design is, the less easy it is to pass this test. Keep that in mind. This one we picked having five because, again, we want to show you a more difficult example. So co-payments, what you do is you project into the future for the following year how much of your benefits are likely to have co-payments applied to them. And sometimes you'll have a $0 co-payment for certain, you know, preventative care benefits or other things that you're really trying to encourage. Other times you'll have a $50 co-payment in this example because you're trying to discourage the use of that service. So here we project it'll be for $0, a $200,000 amount. Let's assume that we're going to spend $1 million total. So $200,000 falls into the $0 category, $200,000 falls into the $10 category, $200,000 falls into the $15 category. For the $20 amount, we predict $300,000. For the $50, we predict the least amount, $100,000. So again, that your total is $1 million in this kind of easy example. Then you figure out how much of the plan's share of the costs falls into those categories. So for example, of the $800,000 worth of benefits that actually have some co-payment, 10, 15, 20, 50, the $10 amount represents 25% of all the benefits that have a co-payment. The most common one, of course, is the $20 one at the bottom. You'll see that that's 37.5%. So of all the benefits that have a co-payment, 37.5% of them fall into the $20 amount. All right, now what do we do? Now, first of all, let's verify that the two-thirds test has been satisfied. And in this case, it is, because we have 80% of the benefits that have some kind of co-payment that apply to it. So again, that means that we can impose a co-payment on mental health and substance use disorder benefits. If that number had been less, if we hadn't met the two-thirds test, then the mental health and substance use disorder benefits couldn't have any kind of co-payments. So even though here in the medical surgical we have 10, 15, 20, and 50, mental health would have been zero across the board. So it's not really parity, it's kind of super parity, where mental health gets treated better than medical surgical benefits. Okay, but we did pass that two-thirds test because we're at 80%. So then once you pass that, then you have to figure out what's the predominant level that applies in this category. And by predominant, that means that you have to basically get to 50.1%. So you have to find a category that applies to at least 50.1%. Problem here, though, is we don't have any at the bottom row that apply to 50.1%. All those numbers are lower, right? So we're at 37.5%, 12.5%, et cetera. So what the rules say is you need to actually combine those levels until you get to 50.1%. So we start with the highest one. We start with the $50 copayment, that's 12.5%. Then we go down to the $20 copayment, that's 37.5%. Add those together, that's 50.0%. Nice, but we need to get to 50.1%, right? And we're only at 50.0%. So we have to combine more. When we combine more, we have to drop back down to the next level, the $15 copayment. That adds another 25%. So now finally we're at 75%. So we've gotten to the magic 50.1% level. We've exceeded it. What happens next? Well, it means that because we had to drop down to the $15 copayment in this situation, that we can't have any copayments for mental health or substance use disorder benefits that exceed $15. So again, it's not parity, it's super parity under these rules. The $20 amount can't apply, the $50 amount can't apply to any mental health or substance use disorder benefits. Let me just pause and see if there's any questions.
Do you have to test if the language for your copayment is identical for mental health as it is for medical surgical?
I think the answer is yes. So again, I think you still have to do this test. If you only had one level, because you still have to make sure that you get to the two-thirds test, right? Because if you fail the two-thirds test, again, your copayments drop down to zero for mental health. So you still have to pass that two-thirds test. So even if the copayments are the same, you still have to at least pass that two-thirds test. So I think, unfortunately, the answer is yes. So again, that's kind of it. And that's the last time I think you're going to see hard numbers like that. So I apologize for putting you through that. That was kind of grueling and boring, I know. But again, why am I emphasizing this? Again, a couple of reasons. Plaintiff's lawyers have become more active. There's numerous cases which are out there now. Usually they're not picking on companies yet. There have been some cases against employers. I think employers have lost every single time in those cases. Usually they've been picking on the big insurance companies, the Blues, the UHCs of the world. But again, they've been uniformly losing those cases, the big companies. So, you know, plaintiff's lawyers start with the big boys, and then they kind of work their way down, and they view you as being farther down the chain. So they haven't really picked on employers yet, but I do think it's coming. In addition, the agencies in Congress are making this a focus. October 2015, a couple points here. October 2015, last year, the DOL issued some FAQs saying that service providers like TPAs and PBMs cannot deny the underlying data on the basis that it's confidential or proprietary. And if you've negotiated any kind of administrative services agreement with any TPA or PBM, you'll see that they want to take the position that all this data is confidential. It's not your data, it's their data. In terms of pricing, discounts, things like that, they want to keep it locked up and hidden from you. If they keep it locked up and hidden from you, you can't do the analysis. You cannot possibly pass this test because you don't have the data. And so again, if they've pushed you on that, you need to go back and renegotiate that. You need to be able to get this data in order to conduct this test. DOL confirmed it last year. If you lock up your data, you're violating ERISA. So it's just that simple now. There was also a new mental health and substance use disorder parity task force created in March of this year to kind of study this, to find ways to improve employers' compliance with these rules. In addition, after the Orlando shooting, you may recall President Obama kind of went back to the well and said, you know, we can't really do anything in terms of decreasing the number of guns out there. What can we do? We can improve mental health. And so let's make another push for mental health under the theory that a lot of these shootings are driven by people with mental health problems. And so he has, you know, kind of made a priority. In addition, there was a House committee that had been sitting for 2 years on a mental health improvement bill. You know, no one wanted to take any action on it after the Orlando shooting. That became the political response, so they passed it out of the committee 53-0 after, again, for 2 years not being able to agree on a thing. Suddenly it moved out. Went over to the House. The House passed that bill 422-2. again, you know, kind of promoting mental health as something we can do in response to shootings. So there's this big political push here. We'll see that there's a Senate has a similar bill. Under the, both the bills, regulators have to come up with action plans for employers to make sure that you're following these rules, that you're running this test, et cetera. Also, we clarify that the parity rules apply to eating disorder benefits, so your plan may not cover it right now, so that would be an expansion under these rules. And it clarifies that residential treatment, again, you can't kind of pick on residential treatment facilities. So, again, kind of a perfect political storm here in terms of these new rules. Is there another question?
Yes.
Going to be busy today, I think. Given the level of data needed, should the TPA conduct the testing?
So the question is, given the level of data needed, should the TPA conduct the testing? I mean, I think it's very appropriate to ask the TPAs to do it, to see if they'll do it. If they don't, I think it kind of falls to you. It also will require coordination with your PBM. A lot of people have a separate PBM. These rules apply to the pharmacy provisions of it also. So it may require some coordination between the TPA and the PBM. And so you may have to kind of force that because they may not naturally want to talk with each other. But I think absolutely going through the TPA is a good first start for sure. Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's see here. One more, I think, last slide here on mental health parity. Just a couple months ago, the DOL issued an FAQ. Again, kind of ratcheting up the pressure, saying that, from my perspective, that this is really written for plaintiffs' lawyers or for providers to kind of beat up on you, saying that it is completely okay under ERISA and these new rules for them to ask you to confirm that that you have run this test and ask you for copies of the analysis proving that you've run that test, asking you for the underlying data, confirming that, again, you've kind of walked through this. And of course, you have to respond within the time period, I think it's 30 days. And so, of course, if you haven't run that test, it would be very difficult to do that and meet the timing requirements. So this FAQ, again, to me is very scary. It's kind of designed for plaintiff's lawyers to just copy and paste it, send it in a letter over to you saying, hey, prove to me that you followed these rules. If you haven't done it yet, again, it's going to be difficult to show that you've done this. So that's it on mental health parity. It's not an exciting topic. It is very boring. So I do apologize for that. But it's just one of those high priority items, I think, now. All right, any last questions on that?
So if a group, you said that each plan, if they're completely like identical, might change, one might pass, one might fail.
Correct.
Because it's based on the claims experience.
Yeah.
So if you run an analysis on one group one time and it passes, isn't it conceivable then that as more claims come in, it would fail 6 months later?
Sure. So so the question is kind of how often do we have to do this, right? You know, because it could change. I mean, do you run the test every single day of the year? Do you have to do this 365 times per year? The answer is you only have to do it once. So you can use 12 months worth of data. And so you use 12 months worth of data to kind of, you know, forecast where you're going to be and then like make plan design changes. But the way it's set up, it is an annual test. So in theory, you know, everybody should be running this every single year for each of your options, you know, inpatient in-network, inpatient out-of-network, et cetera. So in theory, it is an annual test. Absolutely. Yeah. All right. All right, well, that was brutal. So my apologies. But let's move on. Let's forget everything I just said. HIPAA audits. A couple other things we wanted to mention here. From a HIPAA audit perspective, a couple things to note. The HIPAA Phase 2 audits have begun. You may recall that back in 2011 and 2012, the Office for Civil Rights, OCR, which is a division of HHS, U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, started doing random HIPAA audits. They only hit a small number of group health plans, employer-sponsored group health plans. It may have been somewhere between 5 and 20 is the number that I heard back then. So across the whole country, between 5 and 20 group health plans. So very small numbers back in 2011, 2012. They really focused on providers, on insurers, where a lot of the, you know, millions of claim records are stored. because employers, again, usually don't have a lot of those kinds of claims records. So that's where they put their resources in last time. This time we're expecting something similar. I don't think it'll be 5 employers across the country, but I think it will be a small number of employers. Enough to say that, yeah, we are focusing on employers. We're making sure that they have HIPAA policies in place. One of the things that they're emphasizing in their guidance, they've issued some new kind of audit questionnaires, basically, things that they're going to ask you if they audit you. It's not just do you have HIPAA policies and procedures in place, so you do have to have those in place, but they're actually assigned a task, the auditor's assigned a task, of trying to verify that your employees have been actually trained on it, that they actually follow those policies and procedures. That actual following, to me, is a little bit riskier because we have many clients who have written policies and procedures. Problem is they just sit on a shelf gathering dust, no one ever looks at them, no one ever gets trained on them. So the concept of, hey, you gotta take it off the shelf, you gotta put it in front of people, have them read through it, train them on it, is a little bit more daunting because you gotta actually follow the rules. So again, and I think that's specifically why they're picking on that, is because they know that a lot of times those policies and procedures just kind of sit there and get ignored. So you do have to be a little bit more active here. I think if you're a little bit more active, you're going to be in better shape in terms of any possible HIPAA audit which may occur. The other kind of recent focus here from an OCR perspective has to do with business associate agreements. They've really been emphasizing and hitting people with penalties if you have a business, if you fail to have a business associate agreement in place with a new vendor. So if you hire a new law firm, if you hire a new TPA, a new PBM, they really want that BAA in place before they begin receiving PHI. And so what I've been telling clients is you may actually want to have the BAA signed before you sign the administrative services agreement, because a lot of times those will drag on for months after they begin providing services. But parcel out, you know, break apart the BAA, have that get signed, getting very excited here, have that get signed and executed right away up front, but then again, have the rest of it maybe come later, because if you don't, you do risk penalties. In addition, I know we have a lot of brokers here and TPAs too. You are business associates, my law firm is a business associate. They issued 2 months ago in June the first HIPAA penalty against the business associate. We're now directly covered by the HIPAA rules, $650,000. And then in August, so just a couple weeks ago, OCR announced the largest HIPAA settlement, $5.5 million for 3 breaches. Basically, one of them is kind of your standard thing where there was a laptop, it had data on it, it was unencrypted, and then there were 2 other breaches. None of them seemed all that egregious to me for what it's worth. It affected Advocate Healthcare down in Illinois, kind of a big healthcare system. And again, you know, the number of people were impacted were not extraordinary, but they deemed it worth a $5.5 million penalty. So, you know, OCR is doing its best, I guess, to pay down the federal deficit here, and they're being successful. FLSA concerns, kind of, again, a new topic here. And this one's a little bit, this one has not received much press attention. Gilbertson versus the city of Sheboygan. Just happens to be a Wisconsin case, but it raises a federal issue. Very interesting case, potentially a big impact on employers here. And I know a lot of you are kind of looking at those new wage and hour rules about who's, you know, really considered, you know, exempt from the DOL rules on payments and things like that. This is not directly tied to it, but I know there's a lot going on in that area. My labor and employment colleagues kind of help out a number of people with those. This one's kind of tied into it a little bit. It has to do with overtime and benefits. And what happened in this case was the city of Sheboygan was paying a firefighter, let's say $20 an hour, just to keep the numbers easy. In addition to that, they put in $2 per hour into that firefighter's health reimbursement arrangement, into the HRA. And then the firefighter, after a number of years, looked at this and said, hey, when I've been working my overtime here, you have been paying overtime on the basis of $20 per hour, not $22 per hour. So the firefighter was saying that when you pay overtime, it shouldn't be just my straight $20 per hour. You also need to include that $2 per hour HRA contribution. City said that's ridiculous, there's an exemption under the Fair Labor Standards Act where we don't have to include that. But the firefighter sued over it and said, basically as I note there, that when you're calculating what I was being paid for overtime purposes, it should have been again 1.5 times 20 or $33 per hour, not 1.5 times 20 plus 22 or plus 2. So again, the issue kind of came up. And the court looked at this and said, we disagree with you, City of Sheboygan. We agree with the firefighter. You should have been paying overtime on the HRA contributions. That the Fair Labor Standards Act exception here says that if you as an employer are sending the HRA monies off to a third party and you're kind of losing control over the $2 per hour, or if you're putting it into a trust, then you get to exclude the $2 per hour for overtime purposes. But in this situation, the way that the city had it set up with its claims administrator was actually basically prepaying the claim. So if the claim came in at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, the claims administrator would pay it. And then later that afternoon would have the city wire transfer the money over. So it may have been 4 hours later that there was this reimbursement that occurred. But the court said that tough luck, that does not exactly satisfy these FLSA rules, and therefore the $2 per hour counts for overtime purposes. You've been underpaying this firefighter and all the other firefighters for the past X number of years in terms of how you calculate your overtime. Scary from my perspective, because most of our employers don't set up trusts. Most of them have gotten rid of their HIPAA trusts. Also, this irrevocable contribution to a third party, it's not clear that that is satisfied by your typical FSA or major medical or HRA or dental or vision arrangement. So what we've been doing is we've been adding language into our ASAs that we've been trying to update to try to rely on that irrevocable contribution requirement. We've been trying to argue that that this works from that perspective. It's not quite clear if that really works, but that seems to be the best position for now. If it ends up that there's further case law on this, because this is kind of an outlier case, there's not much litigation in this area, if it ends up that this strategy doesn't in fact work, then the next step may be to actually go back to have every client basically set up trusts for every single benefit plan you have. Everything that's self-funded, dental, vision, major medical, FSA, HRA, all those VIBA trusts that we help you terminate, in the past, we may not have to resurrect if, in fact, more case law develops in this area. So, kind of a very annoying provision, and one that I think bears watching for now. Because again, this is just a lower-level district court case, but it's very scary in terms of the implications of it. All right, any questions on that? Okay, cool. ERISA Section 510, another kind of ACA. Issue which has popped up is, as many of you know, in general, if you have employees who are full-time under the ACA, that's 30 hours per week. We had a number of clients who went ahead and modified their hours of employees to bump it down to less than 30 hours per week, right? So very kind of common strategy. Some employers were very public about that. For example, Dave & Buster's went ahead and basically blamed the Affordable Care Act. And its filing said, you know, this is why we're having to reduce everybody's hours. We're having to cut your hours because of the ACA. And what happened was, in this case, we had an employee at Dave & Buster's who said, you know what, you unfairly cut my hours in order to prevent me from getting health insurance coverage. And that's a violation of ERISA Section 510. ERISA Section 510 is kind of an obscure ERISA provision. Many of you have probably not heard of it. When I was a baby benefits lawyer, when I was a young benefits lawyer, my mentor worked in the benefits world before ERISA got enacted in 1974. And he explained to me that the purpose behind ERISA Section 510 was this. Back then, he would help clients set this up. Basically, you'd have employers who would say, okay, we're going to have a pension plan, a defined benefit plan. It'll have a 10-year cliff vesting provision. So if you work for 10 years with us, with no break in service, then you'll be 100% vested in your pension. So some devious employers would say, okay, we're gonna have you work 9 years, 364 days, and then we're gonna fire you at the end of that day, And then we're going to tell you to reapply for your position the following week. We may hire you, we may not hire you, but we're firing you one day short of your 10-year vesting provision. Congress, as you can imagine, thought that that was unfair, so they passed this anti-discrimination provision under ERISA Section 510. And so employers don't do that anymore. But the argument here from the plaintiff's lawyer is that by cutting people's hours, you're basically doing the same thing. You're saying, hey, you know, you would normally qualify for health insurance coverage because we're going to offer coverage to everybody who's full-time. You're reducing my hours down to prevent me from getting into that plan. I don't think it's actually a very strong argument. There's other case law out there which kind of suggests that it's a difficult thing to prove. So I don't think it's a great claim. But this Dave and Buster situation, it did survive a motion to dismiss. So the court said, hey, there could be something here. We may have to look at it a little bit further, forcing it to actually go to trial as opposed to just getting it dismissed. So again, action item, I think, for employers would be, you know, look at your messaging. Don't blame the ACA if you have to reduce hours. Try to massage the messaging, I think. Other ACA penalties here, things to note. A couple quick points. In the past year, there have been two statutory changes which increased penalties from an ACA perspective. So for example, those 1094, 1095 forms, if you filled them out incorrectly or failed to file them, the general penalty was usually $100 per form, kind of a flat amount. That got bumped up to $250. It's not per form per day, so it's just a flat 100 or now a flat 250. So it's not a huge penalty, but there are some additional penalties. In addition to that, the DOL also had to increase the civil penalties that have been sitting out there for a number of years for inflation. So in the past, they never really changed them. For example, the Form 5500 penalty. If you fail to file a Form 5500, it had always been, as long as I've been practicing, $1,100 per day per failure. Now it got bumped up to $2,063 per day, so basically almost doubled because they're kind of catching up from an inflation perspective. The Form M1 penalties have gone up from, again, a nice round $1,100 to $1,500, $1,502 per day. SBC also has a $1,000 failure up to $1,087. So you're going to see these kind of odd numbers floating out there now. And you know, usually these numbers are kind of theoretical. They can be important. Interestingly enough, we were just working on a deal a couple months ago for a client where the other side kind of found a problem with the plan or an alleged problem with our client's plan. When you start looking at the possible penalties which are out there, they really become astronomical very quickly. So even though this is a very minor issue in the grand scheme of things, you know, the buyer's counsel pointed out that if you run the maximum penalties for failing to comply with any of the ACA provisions, the typical ACA provisions, it's $100 per day per individual, and our client had, I don't know, 1,000 people, let's say, covered. So that's $36.5 million in potential exposure per year for failing on a very, very minor ACA requirements. And so if you've been out of compliance for 2 or 3 years, suddenly you're looking at $100 million in theoretical penalties for missing one ACA provision. Of course, you know, that would never actually occur. They'd never really enforce a $100 million penalty over a minor thing. But in the deal context, when the buyer's trying to find some reason to drive the purchase price down, gives them a big hammer to say, hey, you know, we've got $100 million of exposure out here. You need to reduce the purchase price by $10 million to have us take on that risk. So it's a very effective argument in the deal context. New non-discrimination rules, a couple slides on this one. ACA Section 1557, a brand new provision, prohibits health program discrimination with respect to race, color, national origin, sex, age, or disability. It applies to certain covered entities, basically entities which receive federal financial assistance, so kind of a brand new term which is out there. The regulations specifically say that they think that this would include most hospitals, healthcare systems, pharmacies, educational organizations because of the federal grants and loans, insurers that participate in the exchanges, and some TPAs. If it applies to you, you have to look at this. You have to try to make sure you comply with these rules. One other point too, in one of the footnotes, they say that if you receive Medicare Part D assistance, like a subsidy for retiree drugs, it may also apply to you too. So again, if you fall into one of those categories, your health plan may be covered by these rules. You may have to look at it and make some changes. Where we've seen the most changes have to be required is actually with respect to transgender services. We have a number of clients that don't pay for the transitional costs of moving from male to female or female to male. That's generally excluded under a lot of plans. If you are subject to these rules, you probably can't have that kind of restriction anymore. You probably have to get rid of it. You probably have to pay for that kind of coverage now. So that's, a significant change. And that leads to other questions. For example, we have some clients who said, well, if we pay for this once, do we have to pay for it if someone changes their mind? They went from male to female, and now they want to go back to being male. And then what if they flip-flop again? And the answer is that in that kind of situation, if you have a general exclusion where, you only pay for a surgery once, you don't pay for a reversal of it, it's optional, we think you can probably exclude it in that context also because you have more general provision there. Importantly, the new rules, I think, do not apply to you, even if they apply to your TPA. In the proposed rules, in a footnote, they said that that if you were a TPA and these rules applied to you, that you'd have to make sure that every one of your employer plans complied with the rules. And again, the new regulations clarify that that's not true. They've reversed themselves on that. So again, the main way it would impact you is only if you're one of those kind of special covered entities. So I think you're going to be okay as long as you're not one of those special covered entities. If you are, you may have to, again, work with your TPA to take out those kinds of provisions. Otherwise, there's probably going to be some kind of enforcement action brought against you. All right. HRA, let me pause. Any questions on that so far? Okay. Cool. And I know we're doing a lot of grab bag stuff here, so we're kind of jumping from topic to topic, so my apologies. But there's just kind of a lot of little things out there right now. HRA issues. At the tail end of last year, there was an important IRS notice 2015-87, which came out relating to health reimbursement arrangements. And it kind of reemphasized some important points here with respect to HRAs and some other provisions here. One, kind of taking a step back, under the Affordable Care Act, you may recall that in order for an HRA to exist, in order for you as an employer to have an HRA, that HRA has to be integrated with other major medical plan coverage. It's kind of a technical issue, but the IRS feels very strongly about this. So you can't, for example, have an HRA for active employees and then have people be actively in the HRA but not in your major medical plan. That is a no-no. They really want the enrollment to be tied together. So if you're in the HRA, you're in the major medical. If you're in the major medical, you're in the HRA. That's the safest way of handling things. So a lot of you have already done that with respect to employees. But this new Q&A 4 from Notice 2015-87 took it a little bit further and clarified something about family members. Does a spouse who is in the HRA, who can get reimbursements from the HRA, do they also have to be in your major medical plan? What about kids? If your spouse went elsewhere or the kids went elsewhere, in terms of the major medical, can they be covered by the employer-sponsored HRA? And the IRS answer is no, that you need to, again, make sure that the spouse or the kids also have major medical plan somewhere. So it could be through you. It could, in theory, be through another employer-sponsored plan. I don't like that personally. Because even if you know that the spouse has coverage through another employer-sponsored plan today on August 16th, and you rely upon that, what if the spouse loses coverage tomorrow on August 17th? And you have no way of monitoring that, you have no way of figuring that out, you'd be out of compliance from an ACA perspective from August 17th forward. So even though you think you're in compliance, you're not. So I don't like relying upon that strategy. I think it's better to try to keep it within your control, within your knowledge. So that's, again, a big change, and it may require you to coordinate with your HRA vendors, make sure that that they're getting up good data, your TPA for your major medical plan is getting good data. You need to make sure, again, that there's that kind of one-to-one provision. One follow-up question to that we have from a client is, what about COBRA coverage? What if somebody has HRA coverage from a COBRA perspective, but doesn't have it for major medical, is that okay? We think the answer is that that is okay, because they're no longer basically an active employee. For someone else who's terminated coverage, we think that that is okay. In terms of the timing, the first bullet point is the one I just noted about the other coverage, how it could work, but I just don't like it. From a timing perspective, this guidance says that you have until the end of this year to make changes. So again, work with your HRA administrator, work with your TPA, make sure that you have that kind of one-to-one correlation in terms of eligibility and enrollment. So again, you have to act here yet this year. Calendar plans at least have to act before 12/31/2016. Essential health benefits, again, kind of another little ACA quirk, which has been updated. Under the ACA, you probably recall that in general, you can't have annual or lifetime dollar limits on essential health benefits. So if it's an essential health benefit, you used to have a $1 million lifetime limit or a $2 million lifetime limit, whatever it was, you can no longer have lifetime limits, dollar-based lifetime limits. For a self-funded plan, the question has always come up, well, what exactly is an essential health benefit? Because if it's not an essential health benefit, you can have dollar-based limits. You could still have a $1 million limit on something. The term essential health benefits never been well defined by the regulators. What the regulators did was they kind of punted on it. They said for self-funded plans, you can look to a state's definition of essential health benefit, and you can pick that definition. And so, for example, for one of our clients that was worried about this, they wanted to have a $10,000 limit on infertility treatment. They said, you know, we'll pay for $10,000 or maybe it was $20,000 worth of infertility treatments, but we're not going to pay for it forever. If you're here for 50 years, we're not going to have you try to get, you know, pregnant or get your wife pregnant for the next 50 years. We're going to cap it at some point. So they wanted to have that. And the question came up, is infertility treatments considered an essential health benefit? And the answer is that it actually is, in some states, considered an essential health benefit. So we went ahead and picked a different state, Missouri, which treated infertility treatment as not being an essential health benefit. So even though the client had no operations whatsoever in Missouri, Missouri was a nice state, so we chose that one as our baseline definition of what's an essential health benefit. Therefore, they could have the $10,000 exclusion on infertility treatments. So they don't have to pay for their 90-year-old employees trying to get pregnant still here. So that was the basic strategy. The change here is that HHS has updated their list of states in terms of what's an essential health benefit. So if in the past, and then they did this I think back in May, so if you have picked a state, first of all, you should pick a state. If you haven't picked a state, you've been running a risk for the past several years. But if you did pick a state, now you need to go back and look at it because the definitions have all changed. So you may have thought you were kind of escaping and making a good choice, but again, they've updated it, so now you have to go ahead and change it for 2017. All right, any questions on that?
We did have a question come in. Would reimbursements to employers for early retiree insurance count as receipt of federal funds?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the question is, that kind of ERP payment, the early retiree reinsurance program, or other payments, would they count as receiving federal financial assistance? And I think it possibly could. I mean, now the ERP funding, I thought, had all run out. So if it's prior ERP receipts, I don't think it's that big of a deal. I don't think that makes you a covered entity if you received it 3 or 4 years ago and you haven't received it since. I don't think the regulations are all that clear on that point, but I think you're probably okay. But any other kind of ongoing direct payment, I think, is a concern. We don't think you're receiving federal financial assistance just by relying on general like tax provisions. So I mentioned before that you don't have to tax your employees on the value of employer-provided health insurance coverage. We don't view that as receiving federal financial assistance. You're just relying on the tax code. It's not a direct payment to you. But yeah, I think that kind of direct payment could be considered federal financial assistance if you're still getting it. Okay. All right, exchange notices. And I'm just curious, by a show of hands, how many people here in Madison have received one of these exchange notices saying, you've had one or more employees? Okay. A large number of people, and that's not surprising. And if you haven't gotten one, it's almost surprising you haven't gotten one at this point. Because I think everybody's going to start seeing these show up in your mailbox here pretty soon. These are notices from the exchanges. There's about 38 federally run exchanges. There's about 12 state-operated exchanges. And the state-operated ones last year, a couple of them had sent out notices saying, to employers saying, hey, one or more of your employees has come to our exchange. They'd applied for coverage, individual coverage. We've offered them coverage. They'd gotten a subsidy from us. We received some notices last year from employers in terms of what to do on the state level. But the real floodgates opened up in the past 2 or 3 months when the federal exchange in one giant batch started issuing these notices with respect to 2016. So everybody's going to see these sooner or later. And so the question has kind of come up of basically what should we do if we get one of these notices? Should we respond to it? Should we shred it? You know, should we file for bankruptcy? You know, what should we do? And the short answer is do not panic. This is not that big of a deal, generally speaking. I think there's a kind of a straightforward strategy in terms of what to do, how to handle it. First of all, I think double check your documentation. You're only going to get one of these notices if, again, you have an employee who actually went to the exchange and actually got coverage through the exchange. We've received some notices from some clients where the individual is actually not our employee. So they're a former employee. When they went to the exchange, they were asked, who is your employer? They incorrectly listed us. So even though they haven't been our employee for 2 years, they're putting our name down. The exchange has no idea if the information is accurate or not. So they just send out the notices. So first of all, it may not even be your employee anymore. So double check that. And then if it is your employee, then the next question is, should you fight it? And from a high level perspective, it's been interesting. I've seen a major accounting firm that a month ago said basically, we don't think you should fight anything. Just ignore everything, toss it in the wastebasket. You can ignore this because you can always fight it if the IRS actually hits you with a penalty. These exchange notices are sort of leading you on the path to an IRS penalty under those employer shared responsibility rules. Under the employer shared responsibility rules, if you don't offer affordable minimum value, minimum essential coverage to your full-time employees, you could be hit with a penalty. If at least one employee goes to the exchange and gets subsidized exchange coverage. So this is kind of your first bite at the apple, your first kick at the can to try to prevent that later IRS penalty which could otherwise apply. So I think strategically that it's a good idea to try to fight it. So again, some vendors are saying don't fight it, just ignore it, throw it away. We're saying if you think that you offered affordable minimum value, minimum essential coverage to this person, then you should go ahead and appeal it. You should say, you know what? We don't want to wait until the IRS has actually dinged us and asserted penalties. Let's try to prevent the employee from getting the subsidy now, because if they don't get the subsidy, we can't have an IRS penalty. So let's fight it now. If we need to fight it later, we'll fight it again later, but let's at least try to take a stand now. So again, not everybody's doing that. We think that that's a good position, though. In terms of the time, effort, and cost, I mean, these are new forms, so you know, there will be a little bit of time, effort, and cost. When we've been helping out clients, it's been, you know, spending 2 or 3 hours on this. You know, walking through how the clients should respond and coming up with language. So it's not a huge time commitment. And then the good news is once you've got it down, you can basically copy and paste it and put it into future exchange notices. So I do think you should spend a little bit of time making sure that you've got a good kind of set stock response in terms of how you respond back. There is a standard 4-page employer appeal notice, appeal form. You can just Google that, or if you have problems finding it, let me know. I can just email it to you quickly. There wouldn't be any charge. I mean, the Alliance could put it up too. So there's kind of a very quick 4-page employer appeal notice that we've been encouraging people to use. It's very standard, very easy to fill out. So I do think that's a good approach to how to handle it. In terms of contacting employees, we've got some questions from clients about that is, you know, okay, I know Joe Smith went to the exchange and got coverage. Can I talk to Joe Smith and tell him to not go to the exchange, tell him not to get the coverage? And the answer is generally no. Don't discourage employees. There's a new ACA rule out there It says that an employer cannot discriminate against employees, you can't take actions against employees who get subsidized exchange coverage. So you can communicate with them, you can try to, you know, understand why they're going to the exchange, why they're declining your offer of coverage and going out there, but don't do anything that can be perceived as kind of negative in terms of discouraging them from going to the exchanges. Does that make sense before we go ahead with that? Yeah.
Questions.
Yeah, a couple more roll in.
Okay.
We have
someone who's expressing some confusion about the Cadillac tax and how it applies to tax-exempt organizations. They're asking, I know it's been pushed, but has there been any clarification on this? Will there be some sort of pass-through on premiums or other arrangements?
Okay. So Cadillac tax and nonprofit entities, I'm not aware offhand of any kind of exception for them. In other words, I think it applies to all kinds of entities as far as I can recall across the board. So I'm not aware of any specific rules for them, or I'm not even sure what pass-through really means in that context. But again, I'm not aware of any kind of special provisions which have been enacted. I mean, you do have to understand, too, that the IRS has not really come up with any formal guidance on this. Currently, the IRS guidance we have in the Cadillac tax area is basically a solicitation for industry input, saying basically, hey, here's how we think it should operate, here's how we think it applies to on-site clinics, to health FSAs, to dental, vision, et cetera. What do you think? And so there really isn't any formal IRS guidance on that and any of those details yet.
Another question, if we get a notice that a part-time employee is getting coverage with a subsidy, do we need to appeal to tell them they are part-time and we are not required to provide coverage?
Yeah, so that's a great clarifying question here. So I just said, I think it's worth your time in general to appeal. Let me modify that. I think it's worth your time to appeal if you have some grounds to appeal. So, for example, if you didn't offer coverage to a part-time employee, and many of you won't offer coverage to part-time employees, then you actually don't have any grounds to appeal, right? Because you didn't offer that person affordable minimum value, minimum essential coverage because they're part-time. And so you will get exchange notices for part-time people. And so in that context, because again, CMS has no idea who's full-time, who's part-time. They don't know how you're figuring out full-time, part-time. So, if you get a stack of 10 of these exchange notices, only 5 of them may be with respect to full-time people for whom you offer coverage. So in that case, I'd only appeal for those 5 where you actually have something to appeal on. But if it's someone who was part-time, you didn't offer them coverage, save the paper, but there's really no grounds for you to make any kind of arguments there.
One other question came in via text. Going back to the start of your presentation, can you clarify in a partial self-funded plan, if you have 2 plans, can I offer only 1 plan to a particular class of employee, or do I have to offer access to both plans to all employees?
Sure. So I think they're asking about the non-discrimination rules. Remember, I had a little brief note about how non-discrimination rules for fully insured plans are still delayed. We're supposed to have taken effect in 2011. You can ignore them. For self-funded plans, though, we have Code Section 105H, which has been in effect since 1981. So for the past 35 years, you should have been following 105H for self-funded. So I'm not quite sure if they're talking about a fully insured plan or a self-funded plan. If the plans are fully insured, you absolutely can be that discriminatory if you want to be. You have to check with the carrier, make sure the carrier is okay with it. But you could be as blatantly discriminatory as you want to be if it's fully insured, at least for now. Self-funded plans, 105H has some kind of complicated rules about combining plans for testing purposes. And so you want to kind of delve into that to figure out, I'm not sure if these are self-funded plans or not, but you'd have to kind of look at those and do the 105H test. You still may be able to pass, by the way, even if the plans contain different provisions. The due dates for the IRS forms, all these have passed, so you should have already done your first batch of 1094, 1095 filings. The IRS has said that if you had some kind of technical issue where you were not able to file, they still want you to file, they encourage you to file. So they haven't actually closed the electronic system. You still could file if you are late here. So that's good. It has still been open. Not clear when they're going to close it, but it's still open now, which is good. Wanted to give you some late-breaking news. Late last week, the IRS released new draft 1094, 1095 forms for next year. So these are the forms that you'd be filing in early 2017 relating back to 2016 coverage, so the coverage that's in effect right now. So far, the changes appear to be pretty modest. I don't think we're looking at a lot of differences here. Some of the transition relief provisions which had applied previously now got eliminated, but that's not surprising because those were specific to 2015 only. For example, you may recall that if you are an employer between the sizes of 50 and 99 employees, you generally did not have to follow the employer shared responsibility rules last year. Starting this year, you have to do that. So again, the little transitional relief code for those mid-size employers has been eliminated. So lots of little tweaks like that from what we can see. The major change here in terms of a brand new thing that you may have to track is on form 1095C, line 14. You may recall that's kind of the offer of code where you say, hey, we offer an affordable minimum value, minimum essential coverage. If you use, for example, code 1A, you may recall that's kind of the golden offer of coverage. That's the best kind of coverage you can offer somebody. You can never be hit with an IRS penalty for 1A. New codes here, 1J and 1K, relating to what the IRS is now calling conditional offers of coverage relating to spouses. For example, let's suppose that you say, hey, we offered coverage to a spouse, but only if the spouse didn't have other coverage available. So some employers have that kind of spousal carve-out where, again, you'll offer coverage to a spouse if they don't have other employment-based coverage. The IRS wants you to track that, not really from a penalty perspective, because again, from an ACA penalty perspective, you can only be dinged, you can only be hit for not offering coverage to full-time employees and kids. You can't be hit with a penalty for failing to offer coverage to a spouse. So why is the IRS having you track this? The IRS is having you track this because they want to know for exchange purposes whether or not you're offering coverage to the spouse. Because if the spouse is going to the exchange and saying, hey, I didn't have any offer of coverage either from my employer or my spouse's employer, nobody was offering me coverage, the IRS has no easy way of verifying that. So they're trying to get you to verify, hey, we really did offer coverage to that spouse, or we didn't offer coverage, or we offered conditional coverage. So that's the whole concept behind these new codes 1J and 1K here. And so it goes on to say that for spouses, employers should be prepared to provide upon request a list of any and all conditions that apply to that spousal coverage. So in other words, they're talking about for this coverage that you have in place here in 2016, you need to be able to provide to the IRS whatever spousal carve-out language you have, what other provisions you have. Note that that would take effect immediately. So the IRS just told us about this last week, I think Thursday or Friday, but you'd have to be tracking that data right now and being prepared to give it to the IRS in 2017. So it shouldn't be hard to track. I mean, I don't think you're going to forget between now and 2017 what your spousal carve-out terms are, but you do have to, again, be prepared to track it. For kids, kind of similar rules. Not too many clients have that kind of kid carve-out, but if you do, there's very similar rules that would apply in that one also. Also, some minor changes to the B series of forms that we note too. One other quick thing we want to note here too, this reporting, this opt-out provision, kind of ties back to some July 2016 proposed regulations. The proposed regulations reaffirm and kind of formalize what had been a less formal IRS position in the past, having to do with cash in lieu arrangements or opt-out payments. Some employers, many employers actually, have these kinds of cash in lieu arrangements where we'll say to an employee, hey, if you don't join our health plan, if you go someplace else, we will pay you $100 per month or $200 per month or whatever it is to basically not take our health plan. And the question has come up in terms of whether that $100 or the $200 that they don't receive, that they're foregoing, that they're passing up, whether that counts as a cost of the plan for purposes of determining whether the coverage you offer is affordable. And as you may recall, in general, affordability means about, it used to be 9.5% of their W-2 wages. Now I think it's 9.66% because it's been adjusted up for inflation. So again, the affordability test, does this count or not? And in this example that we have here, let's suppose Acme Company has a cash in lieu arrangement. It will provide employees $100 in taxable wages per month if they take another employer's health plan and not Acme's plan. If they do take Acme's plan, cost of self-only coverage is $200 per month. So when Acme goes to run its affordability test to check whether the coverage meets the 9.66% test, is it running the cost as $200 per month, what they actually reach into their back pocket and pay, or $300 per month? The $200 per month that they actually reach into their back pocket and pay, plus the $100 per month that they're foregoing by taking Acme's coverage. And the IRS confirmed that it is $300 per month in this situation. So it makes it harder to pass the affordability test for employers that have that kind of cash in lieu arrangement. In terms of actually implementing this, though, you do have at least until the end of the year. This clarification does not take effect until plan year starting on and after 1/1/2017. So if you're a calendar year plan, this is a January 1, 2017 change for you. If you're a July 1 renewal, you have until July 1, 2017. So there's a little bit of a lead-in time here in terms of how you calculate affordability. So your exposure, I think, is delayed a little bit here. In addition, these new July regulations also provide for a slight tweak to that. They provide a new concept here called an eligible opt-out arrangement, where the $100 in this example would not be taken into account if, number one, the employee declines your offer of coverage, and number two, the employee provides reasonable evidence that the employee and their tax dependents have other coverage available. So there might be a way for Acme in the situation for some of the employees to actually treat the cost of coverage as $200 a month, not $300 per month, as I have in that example. In terms of the reasonable evidence of coverage, the proposed regulations say that you can use some kind of written statement from the employee. So we don't think a verbal one would work, but we think getting something in writing from the employee saying, yes, I have coverage, and maybe asking for additional proof of the other coverage, insurance card, something like that, that should work. And again, in that situation, it would drive down the cost of coverage to $200 per month instead of $300, making your coverage potentially affordable. So again, brand new kind of clarification. Again, all that would be reported now through those new codes, I, 1I and 1J, or J&K, whatever it was on the last slide here, J&K. Okay, any questions on that before we get into errors in IRS submissions? Okay, great. So, in addition to you all receiving the new exchange notices, many of you are getting notices back from the IRS saying that that there are errors with your 1094 and 1095 submissions. Maybe just by show of hands, just curious, has anyone gotten such an error? Again, pretty fair number of people. So, what seems to be going on in most situations is some kind of mismatch between the name of, not usually the employee, but the name of the spouse or the names of the children and the social security numbers that are being reported with respect to those individuals. And we've heard that some of the problems may be employees intentionally lying to you about the social security numbers for their children, for example, that they view that as private information, they're worried about its confidentiality. They're worried about breaches, so they intentionally give you the wrong number. You put the wrong number onto the form, you send it to the IRS, the IRS says, I have no idea who this person is, it doesn't match up. Some other situations we've seen, women getting married and they change their name, but the IRS doesn't know that they've changed their name yet. Or little misspellings with middle initials or things like that. So. We're seeing a whole bunch of these kinds of errors. The question comes up, okay, what do we do about this? Do we have to actually fix it? Can we just ignore it? And the IRS has been a little schizophrenic here in terms of how to address this. If you look at the instructions to the 1094, 1095C forms, it says on like page 4, any kind of error relating to Social Security numbers needs to be corrected. You need to send it the proper notice to the IRS, you need to send a corrected form marked with a C on it to the individual. So instructions seem perfectly clear that you need to fix this. The regulations, we'll talk about in the next slide, seem to perhaps give you a little bit more of an out. We'll show you here in a second here. So the regulations, there were some new regulations that came out in early August, like 2 weeks ago. And the regulations basically say that if you are missing a Social Security number, you have to address it. You have to go through this process of trying to solicit the proper Social Security number. So if your employee gave you no Social Security number for the son or for the daughter, you do have to try to gather that information. They say that the first annual solicitation has to be provided within 75 days after the date that the health plan was opened. What does that mean? Opened? I mean, I've never heard of an opening of a health plan. What the IRS is saying basically is that for these purposes, as kind of transitional relief, that if the person had coverage on July 29th, 2016, when they came out with this new guidance, they first published it in draft form, that that is the date that it's considered open for 2016. So you'd have to go back to the employee and say, hey, can you give us your son's or daughter's Social Security number? And you have to make that request within 75 days, so October 11th of 2016, you have to try and get that. And then you have to do, if you still don't get a response, you have to do a second request by the end of next year. So December 31st, 2017 is when you'd have to do your second request for that Social Security number in order to protect yourselves. Then the question comes up of, well, what if it wasn't blank? What if we actually had a Social Security number, but it was just wrong? Again, the employee gave us the wrong Social Security number for the child. In that case, it's a little unclear. Again, the instructions seem to indicate that you have to fully correct it, that you have to get the correct Social Security number. In these new August 2nd regulations, in footnote 2, there's this mysterious statement that that the IRS does not consider this kind of notice to you to be like a formal notice under, and then they cite some IRS form 972CG or something like that, which again is kind of mysterious. It doesn't tell you what that means exactly. There's some indication that what that means is that the IRS is saying you don't have to formally correct incorrect Social Security numbers, that you don't have to go through this process, actually try and identify the right ones. But it's unclear, and so we're trying to get some clarification from the IRS about that. But the good news, it's possible that there is good news. It's possible that you can ignore incorrect Social Security numbers as opposed to missing ones where you do have to try to gather them. Does that make sense? Okay. All right, any questions on that? Okay, at the bottom, well, let me point out one quick thing here. At the bottom, two bullet points. The IRS has said that it's going to modify its system in next year to clarify this, to clarify what's wrong. Also, I think if you do find incorrect Social Security numbers, it does raise a concern about other issues like identity theft issues. Have you discovered that somebody really is not who they are claiming to be? Do you now have to go back and redo W-2s? Things like that. And then, yeah, what was the additional question we had from an attendee?
Yes, we had a...
We had an employer indicate that they received a TIN validation error on a 1095C when they presented it to the employee and gave them a date to provide the correct information or to provide the correct information to SSA. They terminated their employment. They asked, now what do we do?
Right, exactly. So, I mean, it's a good question. I mean, you may have just kind of discovered identity theft, basically. This person said, you know, I'm Joe Smith, here's my Social Security number. And then when you challenge them, they said, oops, maybe I'm not Joe Smith, and I'll never see you again. So, it does raise a good question. It, definitely outside the benefit scope, I don't know offhand of all the legal issues that can be triggered by identity theft in that context. But I think it's worth investigating and verifying it a little bit. Certainly could impact, you know, other forms, retirement plans, things like that, W-2 statements. Just in general, what's going on. So I mean, I'd be curious. My gut reaction is I think they should look a little bit more into that, but I couldn't say for sure that you have to. Yeah. See, that's the kind of question that never gets to benefit lawyers. We never get interesting questions like that, so it's exciting that it's finally coming up here. All right, so the rest of our time, I'd say for the new wellness program regulation. So any questions before we jump into the new wellness stuff? Yeah.
There was one more question via text. In exchange appeals, how is ACA going to differentiate a family receiving subsidy when the rules are based on single premiums?
Yeah, so So that raises another good question about the exchange notices and you know, how you determine affordability and things like that. You're going to have situations where even if you offered affordable minimum value coverage, it may not really be affordable for that person. So you may set it at, you know, 9.4% of their wages, but they may have tax losses, for example, that drive down their overall household income. So it's very possible that for some of your employees, you will absolutely have offered affordable coverage from your perspective, and you will be protected, you will not be hit with a penalty. But when they go to file for the exchange, they'll be able to legitimately say, the coverage is not affordable because I had a $10,000 tax loss that drove down my income for the family, so the coverage is unaffordable. So they will get subsidies, and it should not trigger a tax penalty against you. So there are going to be kind of unique glitches like that that will occur, that we know will occur. The other kind of related point, which I didn't know previously, is just so you know, none of you, I don't think, have received any notices from the IRS yet actually hitting you with a penalty. We have not seen any indication that the IRS has actually sent out penalty notices. What you've been getting are marketplaces notices, which are sent by CMS. So you haven't actually gotten the IRS penalty notices yet. We don't know how the IRS penalty process will work. You know, be on the lookout for those forms. They, in theory, should be coming, you know, maybe by the end of this year, maybe sometime in 2017. But we don't know when those will come out exactly. The IRS has not given us any time frame for appealing them. I don't know if there will be a model form, et cetera. So that is kind of lingering out there. And, you know, we'll have to see when exactly all that happens. But so we haven't even gotten to the IRS penalty piece yet, because nobody's gotten it any kind of notices yet. All right, so final HIPAA wellness regulations. We'll give you a brief rundown of the 2013 final regulations that occurred, and then we'll bring you up to speed on the new May 2016 regulations and how they impact you if you have a wellness plan. And maybe by show of hands, how many people here have a wellness plan? Okay, so it's a pretty good number. For those of you who don't have one and won't be implementing one, you can tune me out. You may have been tuning me out for the past hour, but you can actually tune me out for sure now. So in terms of the HIPAA wellness regulations here, kind of starting from the beginning, what does HIPAA say? HIPAA non-discrimination rules generally prohibit employers from using different eligibility rules or offering different benefits based on a person's health status. So health status includes your current health status. It includes high claims in the past. Very broad definition for what's health status. A couple important exceptions. You can actually favor people who have adverse health situations. So a lot of clients will cover, for example, disabled kids forever under the plan. So normal non-disabled kids, we cut you off at age 26. Disabled children will cover them indefinitely. We are discriminating on the basis of their health status because they're disabled, but it's a positive discrimination. We're giving them better benefits. That's okay under these rules. Then second, they talk about the more negative one where you try to penalize people for adverse health conditions, saying that you generally can do that. So if you're a smoker or if you are overweight or if you're not scoring well on our point system and our biometric testing, again, you can pick on people a little bit under these rules, but that's kind of a cap in terms of how much you can pick on people. In terms of figuring out whether your wellness plan complies with these rules, first of all, step number one, three-step process, identify the type of the wellness program that you have, and we'll walk you through the different types, identify the applicable rules that apply, which kind of flow from the type of plan that you have, and then apply those rules to the wellness program. So in terms of the programs, not all wellness programs are created equal. Not all of them are subject to all these rules. The first one, for example, is the least regulated plan called the participatory plan, saying that if the individual has to show up and do something, like attend a health fair or sit through a lunch and learn program, and if they do that very minimal, non-physical activity kind of task, then they get the reward. So you show up for the health fair, we give you a $25 reward card. If you attend the lunch and learn, we give you a free lunch. That kind of program. Again, very minimal requirements, basically not much you need to do in terms of complying with the wellness program rules. Where it gets more interesting is on the health contingent side of things, where you're saying, okay, we want you to actually do something. We want you to walk 5 miles, or we want you to lower your BMI to this level, or we want you to cut down on your glucose levels, your cholesterol levels, etc. So those are either activity-only wellness programs or outcome-based wellness programs. So again, we're actually focusing on getting them to do something under that context. Activity only would be individuals required to complete an activity to which relates to a health factor in order to get a reward, you don't have to actually improve your health. So again, if you exercise for 30 minutes a day, even if it makes your health worse or doesn't improve it at all, you still get the reward. That's an activity only program. We're not measuring you to see if you actually improved your health. Just do this activity. We'll assume that that's good enough. That's one kind of category here. The other one would be outcome-based, and this is a little bit more stringent. This is probably the most stringent here, where the individual has to attain or maintain a specific health outcome to earn the reward. For example, not smoking. So if you smoke, that's considered a health status factor, and so we want to encourage you to not smoke. Or certain results on biometric screenings. We want you to improve your cholesterol, your blood sugar level, etc., by X amount. All those are outcome-based wellness programs. If you are in the participatory category, again, kind of the easy category, the only HIPAA requirement that applies is that it has to be made available to all similarly situated individuals. So again, very easy from a HIPAA perspective. In terms of what is a similarly situated individual, you will see some questions about that. For example, we have clients that say, hey, we want to offer our wellness program to our Wisconsin-based employees, but we have one lone salesperson out in California. It'd be too expensive to operate it for that one California person. Do we have to offer it to them? Are they similarly situated? And the answer is no. You can distinguish based on geography. So you can have different wellness programs for different groups of people based on geography. Participants can be a separate group from spouses. So you could treat participants differently. You could have a more robust plan for your employees as opposed to the spouses or dependents. Health contingent programs. This is where the rubber kind of hits the road. This is where if you're activity-only or outcome-based health programs, again, you have to follow these different rules. Frequencies. Individuals must have the opportunity to qualify once per year. Sometimes it does raise questions where many of you may run your program for like, 6 months or 4 months. You know, somebody who's hired at the tail end of the six-month period, there isn't time to complete it. Are you violating the rules? We think the answer is probably no. Regulations don't specifically address that. Again, in general, people have to have the ability to qualify at least once per year for your wellness reward. Size the reward. Generally, 30% of the total cost of self-only coverage can go up to 50% if it's based on smoking cessation. So if you're picking on smokers, you can add that extra 20 percentage points in there. Usually it's easy to tell. We encourage clients to say, we'll give you up to 30% based on exercise and 20% based on smoker status. Sometimes clients make it a little bit more difficult to tell, like in the second to last bullet point here, where they'll say, okay, you have to earn points. And you can earn points by exercising, you can earn points by eating right, you can earn points by not being a smoker. And as long as you get 7 out of 10 possible points, then you've qualified for the discount. So you're going to have some people who will earn their 7 points by not being a smoker, others will be the heaviest chain smoker you've ever seen, but will still get their 7 points in some other way. Are you really picking on smoker status or not? And the answer is it's not very clear. So we kind of discourage people from doing things which are unclear. We kind of steer you to something that's a little bit more clear, if at all possible. If spouses and dependents participate, then the reward is based on family coverage, not self-only coverage. So you can bump it up to a fairly high dollar amount. A program has to be reasonably designed to promote health or improve disease. It has to be kind of a rational plan. Again, full reward available to all similarly situated individuals, like we just talked about. If you do have kind of an outcome-based standard where people have to actually improve their health, you have to offer this reasonable alternative standard. So again, if you say to an employee, you have to quit smoking, but they can't quit smoking, you have to allow them to go to a smoking cessation class or some other reasonable alternative standard. And then if they sit through the class, The old joke is if they're smoking throughout the whole class, you still have to give them the reward because they've satisfied the reasonable alternative standard. They've gone through that other way of qualifying for it. If you have one outcome-based plan serving as the alternative standard for another one, so you say, okay, you can't walk 5 miles a day, we want you to swim, you know, 100 laps a day. That's our alternative standard. Well, some people aren't going to be able to swim 100 laps either, so you need to come up with a different standard. So they kind of cascade down with all these different standards. There's also a notification requirement. Generally, I have to tell people about all these rules, about the alternative standards, et cetera. There is model notice language, which is out there. So again, the 2013 rules, most of you are pretty familiar with them, so I tried to go through them pretty quickly. ADA, here's where things get to be a little bit more complicated, and where we have some new guidance here. ADA, Americans with Disabilities Act, says that employers can't discriminate against individuals on the basis of their disability. And that makes sense. But as part of that, what the ADA provides is that you as an employer cannot require a medical examination or make a medical inquiry of your current employees about their disability status unless the inquiry or examination is job-related and consistent with a business necessity. So for example, a city could test its police officers to make sure that they can see, because we want police officers who can see if they're walking around with guns and firing guns. I mean, it's consistent, job-related, et cetera. So that makes sense. But if you're trying to test the police officers to figure out what their cholesterol level is, why are you doing that? You don't need to know what their cholesterol level is in order for them to be an effective police officer. And the EEOC, Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, has taken the position that these kinds of wellness programs, when you do a health risk assessment or a biometric test, that they are medical examinations or inquiries. So that's their basic position, is that, yeah, these ADA rules apply to your wellness plans when you're trying to gather that information. So again, job-related, consistent with business necessity, strict interpretation by the EEOC, strict interpretation by the courts, kind of difficult to comply with. There are two exemptions. One is for voluntary wellness programs, and one is for bona fide plans. We'll explore these in a little bit more detail. The net result is that under these new EEOC regulations, the EEOC is basically saying, forget any previous guidance, forget any court rulings. The only way to ensure compliance, employers, is to follow our new path that we've set out here in these May 2016 regulations. So this is it. The EEOC is disagreeing with anything that came before it. So for example, in 2011, a very important case out there, Seth versus Broward County. New employee gets hired by Broward County down in Florida. Broward County says, hey, if you participate in our health risk assessment, we'll do this blood draw. You know, we're trying to improve your health. And then we'll give you, $20 more per paycheck. Employee within 2 weeks, brought a class action lawsuit against Broward County. So must have had a brother-in-law who was a plaintiff's lawyer, was looking for something to do or whatever it was, but turned around and immediately filed a lawsuit against Broward County saying, hey, you can't do this. You can't, make this kind of inquiry. You can't penalize me for not participating in this health risk assessment. Went all the way up to the 11th Circuit, so appeals court, and the appeals court agreed with Broward County that this met this kind of exception to the ADA. It was a voluntary plan. They fell within the safe harbor, so therefore there's no penalty according to the 11th Circuit. The EEOC disagreed with that. They filed briefings, they fought it, and they continue to fight it. And under these new regulations, they actually, in the preamble, they actually call out the SEF decision and say, we completely disagree with Seth. We think it's wrongly decided. Even if it's correctly decided, we've now changed the rules, so you can't rely on Seth anymore. So they kind of rewritten the rules to avoid the case that they didn't like. So in terms of, again, EEOC positions here, they've been okay with voluntary wellness programs, but the big issue has always been, what does it mean for it to be voluntary in terms of incentives? Because if you have a truly voluntary plan where you don't encourage people to sign up for it, you don't penalize them if they don't sign up for it, you're going to have a 1% participation rate. You know, you need to give them money to encourage them. And the EOC's position has always been that you can give your employees a coffee mug, you can give them a t-shirt, but even giving them a single dollar turns it into a non-voluntary plan. Any kind of monetary compensation is unlawful under these rules. So they've been enforcing it. So for example, you probably all recall the Chicago office of the EOC had been aggressive in enforcing this back in 2014, filed a lawsuit against Orion Energy here in Wisconsin, against Flambeau here in Wisconsin. Honeywell was going through an open enrollment process where they were gathering information in, I think, October of 2014 for their January 1, 2015 plan renewal. EOC tried to seek a temporary injunction to shut down their health risk assessments program in October. Honeywell fought back. They picked on somebody who was a little bit more aggressive, took it to court, and Honeywell won in court. EOC faced tremendous political pushback as a result of that. There was a lot of, basically the position of the court and the position of Congress, of the House representatives who looked into this was, EOC, you've never issued guidance on what it means to be voluntary. We have these informal, vague comments about t-shirts and coffee mugs. Put it in writing and then come back here. And so EOC did that. They said, okay, if that's what we have to do, we're going to do that. So here's the final regulations that brings us up today, May 2016. The good news under these May regulations that wellness plans are not outlawed. I think the EOC could have gone that way. They could have said, even though the IRS, DOL, HHS have approved them from a HIPAA wellness context, we are outlawing them from an ADA context. They did not go that path, so they did allow for wellness plans to still exist. The bad news, though, is that there's new requirements here, new hoops to jump through. There's new things that you have to do in order to follow these new rules. The way that's set up, now in terms of what is a plan, for these purposes, although I explained to you all that participatory and activity only and all those HIPAA terms, all those get thrown out the window. EOC doesn't care about that. They've created a brand new test for whether you're subject to these rules. And the test is whether or not you have any disability-related inquiries or medical examinations. And for these purposes, again, health risk assessments, blood draws do qualify as disability-related inquiries or examinations. And so, for example, if you have a wellness plan that consists of, you know, attend this lunch and learn, and we'll give you some kind of reward, or, you know, just show up to our health fair or whatever it is, if you're not making any kind of medical examination or inquiries, you would not be in that context, then the full scope of these rules don't apply to you. All these new notice requirements, et cetera, don't apply to that kind of basic plan, because you're not actually gathering medical information about the employees. The only thing which does apply in that context, last bullet point notes, is you have to be reasonable, you have to accommodate disabled people, so if it's a lunch and learn situation, you know, make sure that they can physically get to the lunch and learn place, for example. And the employer can only have, again, de-identified information. We'll talk about the confidentiality requirements coming up here. All right, let's suppose that you go beyond just the lunch and learn, you actually want to draw people's blood, you want to improve their health, et cetera. So what applies then? The biggest change here is that the general cap, there's a general cap of 30% of the total cost of self-only coverage for disability-related inquiries or examinations. So 30%, not 50% as it was in the other slide, and it's all based upon self-only coverage, not family coverage. So the total dollar amount that we're talking about here is a lot less than under the HIPAA rules, generally speaking. When I talk about total cost, though, I do include employer plus employee contributions. So if the total cost of self-only coverage is $500 a month, employees pay $100, employers pay $400, the 30% is based on $500. It's not 30% of $100, it's not 30% of $400, it's 30% of the total cost of coverage. Smoking cessation programs, if you just ask if somebody is using tobacco and is a smoker, they don't view that as a medical examination or inquiry. They're okay with that, so you actually can go up to 50% in that situation. Interestingly, if you test to verify if the employee is lying, like some employers will take a snippet of hair and test for tobacco, nicotine, if you test, then it's a medical examination or inquiry, you bump back down to the lower level. 30%. So you have to figure that out, how you're going to do that. Fully insured, in terms of calculating these rates, it's probably the carrier rate. Self-funded, probably use the COBRA rate, but not the 2% administrative charge. The next bullet point is a very scary one here. Does disease management count towards a 30% limit? So last month or so, the American Benefits Council, which is a big lobbying group, and I know the Alliance participates, we participate in that too, big lobbying group out in D.C., held a webinar with an EEOC attorney. And EEOC attorney said a couple interesting things. One of them was this question. When you talk about a 30% cap towards the cost of coverage, what about disease management? So many of you probably have disease management programs where if an employee has a chronic condition, so they have diabetes, you hire a nurse, the nurse checks to see if that diabetic is taking the insulin, if they're following the regimen, and maybe the nurse makes a follow-up phone call once a month to check in and see how things are going, to avoid complications, to prevent things from getting worse. If the cost of the nurse program is, say, $50 per phone call, and the nurse makes 12 phone calls per year, the cost of that is $600. Does that $600 count against the 30% limit? And the EEOC official said, yes, that it counts against the 30% limit. So as an employer, if you're trying to run these numbers, you can't, under that program, if that analysis is true, you can't just say, okay, we're going to take 30% of the cost of coverage, because if you just do 30% of the cost of coverage, you're ignoring the disease management program, so you'd be giving benefits which exceed the 30% because you're ignoring the cost of those nurses' calls. So if you capped it at, say, 20% and then left you a 10% leeway for the nurses' calls throughout the course of the year, that would give you a little bit of leeway, but the implication is, you may have to cut off those nurses' calls at some point. So if the nurse can make 5 calls instead of 12, and then you've reached the 30% cap, then the nurse cannot make phone calls for the rest of the year, the other 7 months. So the people who need the help the most in that context, you have to cut off the help in the middle of the year because you're hitting the 30% cap. As you can imagine, everyone on the phone was just outraged. This is just a ridiculous position. The EEOC official said, well, it's not perfectly clear, and we probably would take comments on this, and they were joking about, the ABC folks were joking about, you can hear me typing in the background right now a comment letter about how ridiculous this is, that you are telling us we need to cut off disease management programs in the middle of the year for the people who need it the most. So I think the EEOC official was feeling pressure, saying no employer in the country can administer this, nobody's set up to administer this, nobody's ready for this to kick in right now or even for next year. So there may be some relief forthcoming on this, maybe an FAQ document or something like that, but at least as of right now, it's an open issue, and it may cause you to have to modify your disease management programs for next year and cut off the programs for the people who need it the most. So, let me pause. Any questions on that so far?
Okay. My question would be, or what? You know, if an employer doesn't want to cut off disease management programs for those employees that need it the most, what could they do?
Yeah. The question is, or what? And, you know, I don't know what the penalties are, because we haven't had to research this yet. So I don't know offhand what the penalties are. I don't think that they're ACA-like penalties, where it's a $100 per day per individual massive, you know, $36,500 penalty. I don't think that they're structured that way. I'd have to double check and see what the actual risk is. And of course, the real world risk is low. I mean, you know, you have a pretty good bleeding heart argument. Hey, we're trying to help our sickest people, you know. So you certainly have that to kind of fall back on. I don't have any other design or what's right now, unfortunately. Yeah.
If health coaching is part of your program, is that treated similarly to disease management as well?
Yeah, it's a good question. I don't know. I mean, until the EEOC official said that last month, it had never occurred to me that that could even count. And I suspect health coaching might count also. It's an additional benefit that's only provided to people based on their health status. You know, if you have a health coaching need, it seems logical that it would also flow through to that too.
Greg?
But if you're applying a 30 to 50% penalty on any one employee, does that mean you can exceed the 9.62% affordability provision?
So in terms of affordability, that's a good question. In terms of affordability, I don't know if we put it in the slides or not. The regulators have clarified that you can pick on tobacco users, basically, and it doesn't count against you from an affordability perspective. So, for example, if you have a tobacco user surcharge of $50 a month, when you run the 9.66% affordability test, if you're using like the W-2 wages, you can ignore the $50 surcharge. So even though it really does cost the employee not $100 a month, it costs them $150 a month to participate, you run that 9.66% test using $100, if they're actually paying $100. So they've allowed you to pick on smokers, not true for other reasons. So if you pick on people for their high BMIs or high cholesterols or whatever it is, you actually have to take that into account, and it works against you from an affordability perspective. So they kind of split the baby on that one in terms of affordability. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, let's jump ahead now. Let's keep going here. So disease management, kind of a big issue. The other big issue here is which plans does the 30% apply to? And boy, you can tell I'm a lawyer and I get paid by the word, right? Look at all these words here. So let's walk you through this one quickly here. The basic issue is this. Let's suppose that you have three different plans. Acme has three plans: Plan Good, which costs $500 a month; Plan Better, $600 a month; Plan Best, at $700 a month. So total costs $500, $600, $700. Let's suppose that you have an employee who is only eligible. I'm changing the words here a little bit. Suppose they're only eligible for Plans Better and Best, the $600 and $700 per month one. When we talk about the 30% applying and being a maximum cap, what is it, 30% of 500, which the person isn't even eligible for, 30% of 600, or 30% of 700? Does it based upon what they actually enroll in, et cetera? Again, the guidance is a little bit unclear on this. The informal EOC guidance says that the 30% applies to the lowest cost plan, so it's $500. So it's 30% of 500, even if the employee isn't even eligible for the $500 plan. So if they're only eligible for the 600, if they're only eligible for the 700, doesn't matter. It seems to apply across the board, just at the $500 amount. Also doesn't seem to matter if the employee signs up for the $700, signs up for the 600, signs up for the 500. Really doesn't seem to matter. It's capped at just the lowest cost plan, 500 per month. So very strange, not at all how the HIPAA rules work. HIPAA rules focus on what they're actually enrolled in. EOC rules take the opposite position. So again, the EOC is taking the position that some of these rules here are simply clarifications of existing law and are not, in fact, new requirements. These participation rules, et cetera, they take the position that they apply the day that they publish the regulations, and in fact, they apply retroactively. So what else is out there beyond the 30%? First of all, participation has to be voluntary. So you can't tie it to benefit levels or claim levels. We have some clients that use like gateway plan designs. They say, in order to get to our better plan, you have to participate in our wellness plan. So they use it as kind of a gateway plan. According to the EOC, you can't do that and it's immediately effective. So if you are in that category, you'd have to look at that because you would technically be out of compliance. You'd have to maybe offer a special enrollment here in the middle of 2016. To immediately allow people to get into the better plan, according to the EEOC. No retaliation, no requirements to participate. There's a new notice requirement also. The notice requirement is one of the 2017 changes, so this one is not effective today. It's effective for the first plan year that begins on and after 1/1/2017. So January 1, 2017. New notice says you have to explain what medical information will be obtained, how it will be used, who will receive the medical information. So for example, if the wellness vendor is sending medical information back to a few people within your organization who kind of run the benefit plan, you need to explain that concept that, you know, that we hire this third-party vendor, they run the plan, they send us certain basic information back, like you participated in the plan, they don't send us your actual claim scores, things like that. You also have to talk about the methods that you use to prevent improper disclosure of the medical information. The new notice requirement, to me, raises a lot of questions. Number one, can the wellness vendor issue it? They issued some new FAQ documents after these regulations came out, saying yes, but the employer is going to be liable if the wellness vendor messes it up. Do you have to use the exact words in the notice? No. You have to focus on what information is collected, who receives it, how it's kept, when to distribute it. This is kind of a big one. If you have a calendar year plan, they have clarified that you need to distribute it with open enrollment materials. So if you are sending out open enrollment materials in September, October, November this year for 1-1-2017 renewal, this new notice has to be part of it. So even though the rule doesn't kick in until 1-1-2017, their position is that the open enrollment materials in 2016 relate to that 2017 coverage, so you need to issue the notice at that point in time. In addition, you have to, it seems like this is an annual notice, it's not a one-time notice. It seems like every time you have open enrollment, you need to include this as part of your materials or other significant communications relating to the wellness plan. You need to include this notice. It's a little bit blurry on when you have to do it, but certainly open enrollment is absolutely required. The EOC did issue a model notice in June, about 30 days after the regulations came out. I think that your best strategy is to start with the model notice, but tweak it. I don't think that many employers will want to use it word for word because it has some strange language in it. For example, it says that health information will never be transferred unless required to carry out wellness functions. You may have a wellness vendor or an employer. You may be sold at some point in time. You certainly want to be able to transfer it to a successor buyer in that context. So you may need to carve out some exceptions for that. It also has some language, for example, it says information stored electronically will be encrypted. You may not have encryption, or you may not always want to have it be encrypted, because of course if it's 100% encrypted, you could never use it, you'd never see it. So to me, that statement would never be true for anybody in the country, so I don't know why it's part of the model. It doesn't make much sense. It goes on to say, for example, notice that if health information is breached, we will notify you immediately. HIPAA rules talk about notifying people within roughly 60 days of a breach. EEOC rules say you have to notify immediately. What is immediately? I mean, to me, immediately is 1 second later. So if you learned of a breach now, now you have to send out the notice. I mean, that makes no sense whatsoever. To me, it shows kind of a lack of sophistication with the EEOC. Because nobody can send it out 1 second later. So I don't know what immediate is. Maybe they mean HIPAA 60 days is immediate, but it's not clear. In any event, you certainly don't want to tell your employees you're going to send it out immediately, because that's unrealistic. There's also some new confidentiality provisions here too, where if you receive any medical information about your employees, then you have to follow these rules. If you get no medical information about your employees from your wellness vendor, you seem to avoid these rules. What's a little bit unclear is what the rules mean by medical information in this context. Clearly if you were getting test results of your employees, if I went to our wellness vendor and they said, John, your BMI is this, your cholesterol level is this, and then it was sent back to my benefit manager at Quarles and Brady, clearly she's getting detailed medical information, she'd have to follow these confidentiality rules. But what if she gets just information saying, okay, John, you participated and you qualified for a discount? She won't know if I qualified because my cholesterol is good, because I'm an active walker, because I'm a non-smoker. She won't know why I qualified. She'll just know from the vendor that I qualified. Is that medical information or is it not? Again, the rules are not clear on that point. I think it's still an open issue. And so the rules then go on to say, if you get this medical information, here's what you have to do. But they phrase it kind of awkwardly. They say some of these are required by law, some are best practices. They do not tell us which ones are which. So I'm going to walk you through everything that's out there. I have no idea if these are required or not. Some of them are and some of them are not, but I couldn't tell you which are which, unfortunately. So for example, number one, you have to train individuals on HIPAA, the ADA, and any other privacy law. So it goes beyond HIPAA. So even if you're following HIPAA and doing the HIPAA training, you have to train your staff who are getting medical information on all privacy laws that could apply to you. You should have clear policies and procedures relating to the collection, storage, and disclosure of this medical information. Technology has to guard against unauthorized uses. breaches have to be reported to employees again immediately. That doesn't make any sense. Number five, disclose employees who breach confidentiality. I'm sorry, discipline employees if they breach confidentiality. That's a HIPAA concept, that's probably fine. Considering firing vendors for breaches. Interestingly, they go beyond HIPAA. HIPAA does not really call this out. HIPAA says you have to have the ability to terminate a business associate under certain circumstances. This says specifically if there's a breach, you have to have the legal right to get rid of that vendor. So again, that's probably not in a lot of your vendor contracts right now. You have to have a firewall within the employer. Only certain people can get access to this medical information. And number eight, you have to review your vendors' privacy policies. So any vendors, like health vendors, wellness vendors, in theory, you're supposed to ask for a copy of their privacy policies. That raises other questions like, you know, what if the privacy policy is terrible? What if it's junk? What if they don't have one? What do you need to do? Can you just ignore it or not? So that's kind of a big question that's still out there too. So the effective dates, and I think the 30%, again, we have until next year, that's pretty clear. These confidentiality provisions, in theory, apply to you today. They applied May 17th, 2016, the day that they issued the guidance. So if you are getting this information, if you have this information for your wellness vendor, at least in theory, you're on the hook right now in terms of complying. GINA regulations. On the same day that they issued the final ADA regulations, they issued some GINA regulations. GINA is a Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act. By quick background, because I only have a couple more minutes, because I love this story because it's so interesting. have I ever told you guys the story? Maybe have you ever heard the story of how GINA came about, Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act? So there was a railroad company here in the United States that was trying to manage like workers' comp claims. And so what it would do is it would require as a condition of employment that every employee give a snippet of their hair so that they could do a DNA analysis on employees, figure out which employees were genetically susceptible to future medical conditions, and then they'd fire those employees. So they did all this genetic gathering, analyze it, and then got rid of you if they didn't like your genes. And as you can imagine, Congress said, whoa, wait a minute, we don't think employers should really be doing this. And so they passed the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act, which basically says employers can't get genetic information of your employees. So really interesting. These new rules, the only kind of wellness tie that they have here, there had been kind of a glitch in the statute, which said that if you obtain a spouse's health history, that's equivalent to obtaining the employee's genetic information, which doesn't make much sense if you think about it. I mean, if my wife has a health problem, how is that my genetic information? So it's really a poorly drafted statute. But so there had been this ambiguity out there in terms of what does that mean exactly. New regulations say basically, okay, we we can't work our way around the poorly written statute. Congress hasn't changed it ever in all these years. So here's how we're going to kind of split the baby. If you want to gather health information of spouses as part of a health risk assessment, you can do so, but you have to follow these rules. 30% limit in terms of the incentive. You have to also provide a new written authorization. You have to get the spouse's written authorization to participate in it also. Net effect for you all, if you're trying to have the spouses participate in the health risk assessment, new authorization, and you have to cap it at 30% in terms of the maximum discount you can give for that spouse. No EEOC model is available. You're going to have to create it for yourself or have one of your wellness vendors create it for you. Kind of wellness big picture, if I can kind of summarize it for you all, lots of new rules. Walk through the rules. Try and figure out what applies to you. Again, if you're doing those medical examinations or inquiries, the new ADA rules apply to you. If you're having spouse's information, the GINA rules apply to you. HIPAA rules generally apply to you if you're tying it to the major medical plan. You also could have kind of basic wellness plans, lunch and learn plans, wellness fairs, where you basically avoid almost all these rules. So you kind of have to walk through it. There is no one size fits all from a wellness perspective. Last slide on state laws. One thing which I want to mention is actually good news. Yay. I saved the one slide of good news for the end. How's that? The good news here is the Supreme Court, in an ERISA preemption case from March called Gobeil, said that ERISA preempts state laws that try to make you do special reports. Vermont and I think 16 other states had required self-funded plans to gather claims data from their TPAs, send it all to the states. The states were going to create a big database and then use that to benefit, for example, the state employees to negotiate better rates with providers, etc. Supreme Court looked at that and said, no, ERISA preempts that kind of law. We're not going to subject employers to, you know, 50 different collection requirements, data collection requirements. So just across the board, good news on that one. No action items for you all on that. Any questions?
There was one question from Rockford, which is, what is the penalty based on spend or cost? I think that was two previous sections.
What is a penalty based on? So I'm not quite sure what the question means. But again, maybe it's referring to 30% of cost of coverage. And I think I referenced how if it's fully insured using the carrier rate, self-funded using the COBRA rate. So I think that may be what they're referring to. So really look to the COBRA rates if it's self-funded. Okay, well, I am going to let Cheryl, I think, take over. But thank you for being such a good audience. Thank you.